I was fairly quick, and I was first away, and I had a tremendous lead on the first lap. I went through the kink in the straight fairly cautiously, and braked very, very early. In fact, I took it very easy on this first lap.
It's the first year that Ford's really been serious about Le Mans.
Out onto the straight for the first time, and I sort of wonder who's up ahead there. I can see the chaparral fairly well ahead. Surprisingly enough, no one seems to be in any sort of drama at all. Generally have at least one or two in the sand. But everyone's being careful, pretty much trying to stay out of harm's way.
People there, the stands are packed and the pits are packed, and the balconies over the pits are just streaming with people, and it's a very impressive sight.
But I think the chances of a Ferrari camp should be very good.
Obviously the chief competitor is Ford's.
The main thing is Ford, but you mustn't discount also the lone chaparral. But it's a very long race and rather a freak race, really. I mean, a race is perhaps the wrong way to completely term it. It should be more of a sort of endurance run.
Ferrari è stata in testa a Le Mans per molti anni, ma credo che le Ford quest'anno daranno loro delle difficoltà, eh?
Speed doesn't mean very much in this race.
No, it's endurance.
Yeah, you get a few headlines if you're the fastest in practice, but very seldom do you see the people that are fastest in practice get the checkered flag on Sunday afternoon.
Driving this track is that if you do have to brake suddenly, you can't. I
mean, no.
If you come up against a small car which changes course in front of you, so you have to put on the brakes, there's nobody home.
You know, Boule is a game we play mainly in the south, in Provence. We call it pétanque, you understand? It's mainly played in the evening, and we have many clubs in the district who play this game, who take part. Even the children, you know, we teach them to play when they are quite young.
Enjoyable driving through that. The landscape just seems to go by. But very difficult because when you're overtaking slower cars, it's one line that's the best way to go, and it's difficult to position yourself, and particularly since we're not the fastest car through there. The Fords, of course, and the better Ferraris and so on are faster, and you can frequently have the problem, which is the biggest problem here at Le Mans, which is a car passing a slower car and maybe being passed by a car that's even faster.
Dinner on the Saturday night consisted of a salmon salad, and breakfast on Sunday morning consisted of a salmon salad also, and numerous cups of tea in between.
Mais il y a plus de visiteurs étrangers que de Français.
I was second behind Graham Hill.
Kind of a crash, and the front suspension fell into the road, and a shower sparked, and the car weaved about all over the place.
And then I finished up here about bloody nearly last, because I just had to coast around, you know.
I got a lift back to the pits in an ambulance, which was, pleased to say, I was in good order, because the ambulance ride, I think, would have finished anybody off.
Guys, a decent car, and all you do is brake.
At night, you have to watch. You have to. Be a little bit more careful placing the car. You have to look for the inside of the corners, and of course, there is the illuminations on the side of the track, the advertising. There is the headlights of the other cars. So I was looking forward to the daylight itself. And as that came up, you could consciously start relaxing a little more and just take relief, in fact, out of the fact that now you could at least see where you were going.
First, number 1 Ford is 159 laps. Second, number 3 Ford, also 159 laps. Third, number 2 Ford, 156 laps. Fourth, number 5 Ford.
But then we got into a problem. The sun came up going into the yeses, and you come over the brow of the hill, having just gone underneath the Dunlop Bridge, plunged down into the S's, and suddenly you could hardly see a thing. The sun was so bright. The only thing to do then was to collect my sunglasses next time round we had a pit stop.
I passed by Ford, just preceding the, I guess it's the White House section down here. And I went in, and what seemed to be a reasonable rate, but the Ford, of course, I think Gurney was driving, he just went through flat out. And I noticed right away that just the enormous gap that settled in between us, and he just continued to draw away all the way down here.
I got a little bit bothered by another fellow that was coming along and dancing all around behind me and everything, so I just stood on it for a while.
Because he's a fast man, and no one would dispute this. Has someone got the watch, by the way?
We had cold air ducted into the cockpit of the car, and this was our only real problem throughout the race, because I like to get the duct adjusted so that it blew the cold air on my face, and Chris he didn't like the cold air on his face, he turned the duct away. At the end of 24 hours, little things like that can start growing into big things. It's a bit silly, really.
Relaxed, confident, sort of intellectual approach to things, I think is the way to do it.
place number 2, Ford. In second place number 1, Ford. In third place number 5, Ford. Fourth place number 30, Porsche. Fifth number 31, Porsche. Sixth number 33, Porsche. Seventh number 32, Porsche. Eighth number 58, Porsche. Ninth position number 29, Ferrari. And in tenth place number 57, Ferrari. The only two Ferraris left. 11th place number 62 Alpine, in 12th place number 45 Alpine, in 13th place number 44 Alpine.
By the middle of the morning, the tension was starting to build up, and we were in the lead. And looking towards 4 o'clock in the afternoon and the finish of the race, this is still 6 hours away. I spent most of that time up till the finish trying to work out what was going to happen, and just hoping and praying that nothing was going to break at the last moment.
I think it's 4th, 5th and 6th and 7th are all poor, team Porsche. Most of the cars in our cars blew up yesterday, so maybe the race is longer, we blow the Fords off too.
Did you anticipate the Porsche team to be as big and as strong as they were?
No, they are fantastic. Porsche makes a good show.
They've only got another 20 minutes to go.
How far are they in the lead now over the Porsche team?
You should think about 10 laps. Well, there's no chance of them catching up unless something drastic happens. I should think even if they stop, there's only about another 5 laps to do.
Suddenly it came down very, very heavy. Down the straight it wasn't too bad, providing you stayed in the middle of the road just in case something went wrong, but it was still cruising down there at about 145 to 150, I suppose. We weren't losing too much time. I was knocking it out of gear and just letting it coast around the corners because we couldn't have been doing any more than 5 mile an hour. Around the corners and then bumping it into gear again, slowly pulling away. But this is just the worst time of the lot, probably. during, when the road was dry, it was even difficult in low gear as it was to get around the corners. And when it became wet, it just bulldozed the car straight on.
He said, oh, you're in the lead, which was somewhat of a surprise to me. The main thing by then was to just keep running. The order didn't matter, as there were three Fords in the lead anyway.
Abby, wonderful.
And directions and rules of the race, it is laid down that if there is a dead heat across the finishing line, the car that started farthest back on the starting line must have covered the greatest distance. So number two becomes the winner. This is a remarkable result, and I congratulate the French, and I think this is the most splendidly thought out set of rules for any race in the world. And I think we're all lucky to be here to see such a race.